Welcome to this episode of Eureka, and we are bringing this episode from Mysuru, known for silk. We are at the Central Sericultural Research and Training Institute. Do you know the quantum of silk that we produced in 1958? That was just 1,000 metric ton. Can you guess what it was in 2018? You'll be shocked. It's close to 35,000 metric ton. This phenomenal increase could not have happened without research input and training input by institutes like them. We are going to have this conversation with the director in charge of this institute, Dr. Pankaj Tewary. Before we continue this conversation, we'll take a quick look at his brief profile and continue this conversation. Keep watching. This conversation is going to be very silky and shiny.
Is the important part of the tradition and culture of India. Even experts say that sericulture is a rural-based and high employment-generating, profitable enterprise for India, which plays a vital role in the socio-economic development of the country. Not only this, India is the second largest producer of silk after China. To continue such developmental efforts and to conduct research activities in the tropical sericulture areas, Central Sericultural Research and Training Institute was established in Channapatna. Presently, Dr. Pankaj Tewary is heading the Central Sericultural Research and Training Institute in Mysuru, where he is leaving no stone unturned in taking the institute in the top ranking in sericulture. He obtained his PhD from Gorakhpur University in Zoology, with specialization in entomology in the year 1984. Dr. Pankaj Tewary has a major contribution in silkworm breeding and silkworm seed sector. He developed two double silkworm hybrids and also conceptualized the breeding of green, yellow, blue and almond tusser silkworm lines for robustness. Dr. Pankaj Tewary received many recognitions, and noted among them are Innovator of the Year in 2012 by Uttarakhand State Science and Technology Congress.
Thank you, sir, for being with us. It's a very wonderful opportunity. You have a very wonderful institute who seem to be bubbling with enthusiasm. We can see that all around. So let me ask a very simple question. I mean, most of us know when we go to a shop and we want to buy a silk sari or a silk dress for our family members, we would be asking, is there a Kanjivaram silk? Yeah. Oh, where is the Mysore silk? Oh, Banaras silk is better. So how many varieties of silk is there actually?
Silk has four varieties. Number one is mulberry. Number two is tassar. Tassar is again divided into two, that is tropical tassar and temperate tassar.
Okay.
Then there is airy silk, and then at last munga silk.
Oh, so which means that the nomenclature like Mysore silk, Kanjivaram silk is basically the place of production, not the type of silk.
Yeah.
Right? The
definitely.
Type of silk is only four.
Yeah, yeah. And these Kanjivaram or Banaras silk, it is all mulberry silk only.
They are all mulberry based silk only, right? That's a very interesting point. Most of us may not even know that. Yeah. So let me further this question. Are there only these four varieties all over the world, or is it just that in India we have these four varieties?
No. Economically viable silks are these four only. And fortunately in India, all the four types of silks are available. Muga silk is indigenous to India only.
I see.
And that too in northeastern part of our country.
So this is very interesting, because generally most of us think that silk came from China.
Yeah, so that's true.
But you say that Muga silk is indigenous to India.
Yeah, yeah.
So which means that it is only that mulberry silk and other kinds of silk came from China, but whereas Muga silk was indigenous here. Is that
yeah,
correct?
Yeah. Actually, mulberry silk came from China. Other tassar, airy and munga, they got originated in India. Tassar also got originated in China simultaneously.
Okay. Uh-huh.
But we have all other, and collectively we call it vanya silk.
Okay. Fine, sir. That's an interesting thing. So now let's look at these four varieties of silk. Which variety is actually highly cultivated, produced and consumed?
It is mulberry.
Mulberry is the one which is highly produced and consumed. Why mulberry? Okay, let me just start with this question because many of us may not even know how actually silk is produced. I mean, vaguely one might have heard. So let me ask, how is actually silk produced? What is silk? Is it something produced from a plant or is it, what is it actually?
No, all the four types of silk are produced by silkworms. Respective silkworms. And the respective silkworms feed upon respective food plants.
Okay.
So it is like that only.
So each of this silkworm has a particular desirous plant which it feeds and then produces the silk. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So in the silk production, in the silkworm, one hears that there are five stages of growth, right?
Yeah.
So can you explain us that five stages of growth? How does it actually happen?
Yeah. Actually, in any life cycle, for example, we take mulberry. In mulberry, we start from eggs.
Okay.
So, from egg, the hatching of eggs takes place, and from that hatching, our rearing starts, silkworm rearing starts.
Okay.
So, there are five stages. In between, there are four molds. And in fifth and final stage, after feeding for 6 or 7 days, they will start spinning. What is spinning? Spinning is silk coming out of spinneret from the mouth of the silkworm.
Okay.
When it comes out, it is in liquid form, but after coming in contact with the air, it solidifies and that is silk. The silkworm forms cocoon to get inside it for its metamorphosis, mm-hmm. To change into pupa and then ultimately to moth, male and female moths.
Okay.
So, when the moths came out, they copulate and then female lays eggs and the same process starts again.
So, yeah. the stages of silkworm is something very close to what we might have heard about butterflies in our school. Life cycle of a butterfly, right? Something very similar. But only thing is that the cocoon of butterfly is not useful to produce silk, but whereas the silkworm cocoon is useful to produce silk. You said that the silkworm spits from his mouth, and that is what actually becomes a... So it is something like very clearly like something like spider's web, right?
Yeah. Spider silk is also silk, and in strength terms, the strongest silk is of spider, that too of the black spider.
Okay, but we don't commercially use them for weaving clothes?
No, we don't use them, but in Italy, they have started using it commercially also.
Very, very interesting. One would have never thought of thinking of spiders as producing some clothes. Yeah. Okay, so now let me ask you some more questions about silk that most of us have. See, when we go to a shop, we see silk in many colors. I mean, some are copper blue, some are deep red. In India, there is a large parts of the world, I mean, dark part of the India where on marriage day, I mean, you are supposed to wear a reddish dress. So you buy a red silk, right? I mean, these are all things. So what is, how many colors silk actually is produced by these worms?
Actually, mulberry silk, it is creamish in its natural color. Okay. So when you can dye it according to your need.
So, when a mulberry silk is produced, it's only cream in color?
Yeah.
Okay, what about the other three varieties?
In mulberry silk, if it is bivoltine, it will be creamish, or if it is multivoltine or multi into bivoltine cross, then it will have some yellowish tinge.
Okay.
Uh-huh. So, like that.
Okay. Then what about eerie?
Eerie, it is creamish to whitish, mm-hmm. But it is rough. Okay. Eerie is rough.
Eerie will be slightly rough.
Yeah.
Okay.
Uh-huh. And coming to tussar, tussar is creamish but towards copperish.
Okay.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Creamish with some copper hue, that is what will be the color of...
And munga is naturally golden color.
Naturally golden color. Yeah. So that munga will be like a real golden...
It is called golden silk.
It's called golden. Okay. Very interesting. So all the colors that you see in a cloth shop is actually artificially dyed, is it?
Yeah.
So, but some people are talking about naturally, genetically modifying the organism to produce color. Is it something that is...
We have heard under this institute only. for genetically modified this silkworms, and we were able to produce color silk in this institute. Still, we are going in that direction, and we are doing it.
But still, you think it is not ready for wider?
Yeah, it is in primitive stage.
It's in the very primitive stage. That's a very interesting thing. We got some basic idea about silk, though all of us like silk, and then perhaps bought it and have desire to buy it. We got some very interesting aspects about silk which we were not very much aware till now. Thank you for it. We'll take a very short break. After the break, we are going to talk about how research and training of this institute and people like him had actually changed the face of sericulture, that is silkworm rearing and producing silk. That technology is called sericulture. How it has changed in this country in the last 40-50 years. Keep watching Eureka. We'll take a very short break. Welcome back to Eureka. We are having a very wonderful conversation with Dr. Pankaj Tewary. He is the director in charge of Central Sericulture Research and Training Institute in Mysuru. So before the break, we were discussing about some aspects of silk, and we wanted to know about some about silk. Now let me ask about your research work. You have been part of this network for about almost 40 years, and you should have done quite a lot of research on various aspects. And one of the things that struck me when I was looking at your research profile is that you wanted to create cups for silkworms to lay eggs. Tussar silk.
Yeah.
But that's something very, very, what I should say, I mean, very intriguing. I mean, why should you develop a cup for eggs to lay? Can you describe that whole problem?
Yeah. Actually, I joined way back in 1982, and that time I was in Tussar. So in Tussar, the egg laying by female moths, at that time it was some problem, because females could not lay almost all of its eggs because of anchorage. Female anchorage was not proper. So it was laid in sweet boxes like we use for our pastry and this and that. So at that time, to get it proper anchorage, we devised an earthen pot.
Let me just clarify here. I mean, if I am looking at the same Tussar silkworm in wild, it will be laying its egg on some leaf, right?
Yeah.
So how does it lay in wild?
Actually, in wild, in Tussar or any vanya silk, if they are reared naturally on trees of respective food plants, then there during rains, when onset of rains is there, then male and female emerges, couple, and then female lays eggs on the tree itself. After 10 days or so, the small worms will come out and start feeding on the food plant. And ultimately, after completing the stages, they will form cocoon there itself.
Okay. But for our production, that will not be useful, so you have to rear it inside your house.
Yeah,
that is the problem.
Yeah.
Earlier, what was the method people were using to rear this eggs inside the house?
Actually, in Tussar, still it is reared in field. Now we have organized plantation of food plants in Tussar, and still it is done in field only, but in an organized manner. So even in organized manner, when the cocoons are formed on trees and they are brought back to the room for further processing for continuation of generation, then we will have to hang it like garlands in a room, and males and females will emerge, couple there, and then female will lay eggs. So for egg laying device of those females, to get the maximum eggs from her abdomen, we devised that method way back in 1986.
So can you describe that method? What did you exactly do?
Yeah, that was an earthen pot. We have earthen diyas for our Deepavali or like
lamps,
that.
Okay.
So flat one, and with holes in its walls, small, only half an inch height. And there we will put the female after cutting its wings. In tussar, females are quite big, like our palm,
okay.
So after cutting the wings, we put that female into that, and in earthen pot, the female gets very good anchorage, and it can lay maximum of its eggs there. One above the other, we put the earthen pots.
Oh, then it'll you'll be able to harvest most eggs.
After 2 days, we will remove the female, collect the eggs, and then we process it for delivery to the farmers.
Okay, fine. That's a very interesting thing. So that was one of the major work this network of Sericultural Institutes and other supplying worms to the or eggs to the farmers. So in egg production, that is one point
Was seed station only.
Okay. See, the other area that you were working was related to double hybrid.
Yeah.
That is finding a better suitable worm or let's say species, right? Hybrid species which can produce
silk
more.
Silkworm hybrid, mulberry silkworm
hybrid. Yeah, can you tell us what exactly is this double hybrid?
Actually, in mulberry, there was a concept of single hybrid. Single hybrid means one breed male, other breed female, and crossing, then that is single hybrid. If it is double hybrid, then one set of single hybrid and other set of single hybrid, they are crossed together, and that the progeny is called double hybrid. So nowadays, some 5-6 years back, we are very particular about double hybrid because it provides more grains per female to the industry and ultimately more production in mulberry.
So this is one of the major work that you did in your career, right? So this is a very, very interesting and very fruitful research in your 40 years of career, and this is where we'll take a very short break. Keep watching Eureka. After the break, we are going to talk about how works like this has impacted on productivity and increased silk production and farmers' income in this country. Keep watching Eureka. Welcome back to Eureka. We are having a very wonderful conversation with Dr. Pankaj Tewary. He is the director in charge of Central Sericultural Research and Training Institute in Mysuru. Sir, another area that I want to ask you is that you worked on synchronized hatching of
maturation
of Thakur. I mean, why the synchronization?
Actually, in our area in North India, during fifth stage, when the maturity of the silkworms are taking place, so farmers could not provide them sometimes the adequate leaves due to certain problems and not proper upkeep of the worms. Then this synchronized maturation will save their money, save their time, and produces silk almost same quality. So we had worked on one phytoegg diesteroids with along with the collaboration with Forest Research Institute of Dehradun, and there we produced some hormone, and it matures the worm simultaneously within 12 hours.
That's an interesting thing. So that's also one kind of a technological input to the farmers for getting better production and better output of their labor. What about your work on mulberry plant? I mean, in terms of, let's say, an indicator, the amount of mulberry or any such plant created or produced per hectare, per year, have you been able to make productivity increase?
Productivity in mulberry by the mulberry varieties available as at those times, we were producing some 15 metric ton of raw silk per hectare per year. Okay. Now we are producing more than 65 up to 70 metric ton of mulberry per hectare per year.
So some from 15 to about 65. That's a kind of increase that you have been able to do in the mulberry. Yeah. So why only mulberry? What about the other species? I mean, other plants which are are you working on them also, or they are not there wild plant?
Our department, Central Silk Board, is working separately for each entity. For Tassar, there is one institute at Ranchi in Jharkhand. They are looking after all the Tassar sector, food plants and silkworm. For Eri and Munga, we have one institute in Ladoigarh near Jorhat in Assam. So they are taking care
of it. This institute is mainly looking after mulberry because this region grows mulberry. That's what you... Okay, this institute was formed way back in 1961.
Yeah.
So if you look at the history, I mean, if you look at the old reports and everything, I mean, from 61 to about 80, you see one kind of activity from this institute. From 80, you see a completely a different kind of activity. Yeah. Can you, in short, tell what happened in this whole period?
Before Rstv, we were very conservative nature in our work. Our farmers were doing, breeds were not good. After Rstv and during 90s, with the help of JICA, Japanese International Agency, they came here and they provided us the modern technologies for sericulture. And that was the turning point for us. After that, a lot of changes have come in productivity of mulberry, in silkworm productivity, cocoon productivity, like that.
Okay. So that whole major technological change happened around 1980s. That's what you're saying. So if you look at this institute, so in the past, let's say 20, 30 years, I mean, maybe even after the post-80s when you started using modern methodology. What are the important, let's say, inputs that this institute has been able to give to sericulture farmers in this region?
We have developed silkworm hybrids. As I said, single hybrids as well as double hybrids, bivoltine hybrids as well as multi into bivoltine hybrids, and that has changed the scenario in southern India, in all the 6-7 states of southern India, and our farmers could fetch a very good crop out of those hybrids now. Similarly, in field of mulberry varieties, we have developed several mulberry varieties for proper zones, for proper seasons, like that we have developed. And
So which essentially means that once upon a time, you were not able to cultivate this sericulture all through the year, but now you can almost do it all through the year. That's what you are trying to say.
That's true. That's
that
true.
That kind of a change because of the technology change has been able to bring about. That's a very interesting point. So now let me understand where we are in the silk in the world. If you look at the world, where are we? I mean, in terms of numbers, statistics.
Oh, yes. Last year, the production of raw silk in whole world was about 160,000 metric ton, like that. China was on number one with 120,000 metric ton of raw silk. And in India, we are producing now more than 35,000 metric ton of raw silk. So China is number one and India is number two.
Okay. I mean, who are then our competitors? Who are coming very next to us? Who in the international market will be?
China and India, there is a huge gap. Similarly, after India, some countries are there, huge gap is there.
So in terms of silk, in terms of, let's say, silk exports, one of the major we earn foreign exchange, also jobs in this country, etc. What is the contribution of silk to the international trade from India?
Actually, as I said, after JICA, we became quality conscious. And we started to produce gradable silk. Now we are producing up to 4A grade silk.
Okay.
That is required for export. Government of India doesn't allow non-gradable silk to be exported. So we are producing now gradable silk up to 4A grade, 2A, 3A and 4A grade we are producing. And we are exporting to many countries.
So in terms of production, we have grown tremendously. Like earlier I was pointing out, at one point of time we had just about 1,000 metric ton. Today we have about 35,000 metric ton. Although we are second in world production, like you pointed out, what is our export earning out of it?
Last year, we had exported to the tune of 2,032 crores of rupees from our country.
From our country. That's about 2,032 crore, that is the export earning that we got. So, which also means that suppose if we had not got this kind of a productivity increase in these years, we would have been importers, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So,
we
in a sense,
import.
That would have been a very major trouble for us in terms of foreign exchange and various things. So, let me now move to another question. Good, we made a progress from 58 to 2018, but we are now in 21st century. So, we need to think differently, I mean, perhaps, right? So, what are your plans for future? We can't be doing the kind of same work. We need to think newly, no? So, what are your future plans?
Okay. Now, we are inclining towards value addition. Value addition in field of silk, in field of our sericin and fibrin protein. So, we are working towards many uses of sericin as well as fibrin in medical application, in cosmetic application and like that.
So going beyond apparels and cloth, I mean, you wanted to exploit silk proteins for other purposes, right? So most of us think that when you produce silk, raw silk, let's say, I mean, you produce a thread and maybe we think that it is used for apparels. Is it the only use for silk or there are many other uses for silk?
No, many other uses for silk as well as byproduct utilities are very much there. For example, as I pointed out, in medical applications, we are working towards medical applications of our fibrin silk because it is having very good strength. From pupa. From pupa, pupa has protein, so it has its own nutritive value. So we are working towards exploitation of its nutritive value towards food. So we are working on those lines also. Similarly, for mulberry and silkworm, we have transgenic mulberry, transgenic silkworm, and we are exploiting these for enhancement of our production.
That's very interesting, but we need to end the conversation here for lack of time. If not, we could have continued discussing many other interesting aspects about silk. For want of time, we'll end this conversation here. Keep watching Eureka. We'll come back with another episode next week, same time.